Hi everyone, in this video I'm going to tell you about the Christmas story, and as all good Christmas stories it starts on the 24th of December, and it starts with the bug report, of course. So this bug report is related to the Git Delta open source project written in Rust, So in this video, basically, I'm going to show you what this issue is about, how me and the maintainer of the Git Delta repository handled it, and what we learned about this issue. Basically, we learned a lot about the function std process exit in Rust, which I learned that you should never use it almost, and also about the dropped rate in Rust, which is basically the way that Rust handles destructors. So if you're interested, stay with me. Okay, so this issue says that after the release 0.4.5 of the Delta project, this guy under Ubuntu, it says that after he run Delta, he cannot type anymore on the terminal, basically. So if you have a terminal, it's like after you run cut, like, sorry, like, I don't know, touch. You run a command. After you do it, you cannot see what you're typing. So basically, you cannot see this. But how can we do to reproduce this issue? We can go to the releases page, check for this release, and here we can see the commit that the last commit of this release, basically. So we can copy it, and we can do here, this is the Delta repository. We can do a checkout on this commit, and here Git will go back to this moment in time, basically, when there was this release. So if you do git status, you should see that we are on this commit 66F, which is this one, 66F. Okay, so let's see how we can reproduce it. Let's build the release of this version of Delta. So cargo build dash dash release. And now it's compiling. Okay, now it finished compiling the release version. In fact, if we run here, this is the where cargo puts releases version of your executables. If we run this command, it says that you have to run the executable by specifying also the files, the right files. But if we do a dash v in order to get the version, so it's like we do dash dash version, we see that we are on the right version, the one that we want to debug. Instead, if you do cargo install git delta, you see that on my system I have delta to the latest version. So if I do delta dash dash version, it says that I'm on this version, of course, because this is the executable that we have in our project that we have compiled, while this is the executable that I installed on my system. So if I do which delta, yeah, you see it's installed here under my .cargo directory. Instead, here we are under another project. Okay, so now I have these two files that are the ones that are that the user used as an example. So I just recreated them locally. So I have AAA and BBB. If we do delta, which is the latest one where this issue is solved, you can see that the comparison works. But in reality, the comparison works here also on the 0.45. I will show you. So this is the path to the project. Then I say target release delta, and then I can say IAA BBB. Okay, it works, and we can still type. This works because here I'm using ZSH as my shell. You can see this by doing in SH. No, you can see by doing. Okay, you can see by printing your shell environment variable. Now, if you want to use bash, for example, we just type bash, and basically, if we run this command again, we can still type. But if we run this command, so the executable that we compiled, you can see that we cannot type anymore. So I do Control C to show my prompt, but if I type here, it doesn't happen anything. So what I did is I said I was able to reproduce it, but with ZSH works. And then basically, I think that Dan doesn't have a Ubuntu machine. He tried with Docker, but it wasn't able to reproduce it. And so basically, I said I go back commit by commit to identify where the problem start. I mean, it was complicated to find where this bug is just looking at the code. So I said basically this is the commit history. The commit that we're interested in is here. Is this one, 6xff. And so I went back in history commit by commit in order to check where this issue started. So I will show you. For example, here I found after some debugging that the problem was introduced in this commit. So let's search for this commit in the Git history. Here it is. So basically, if we do a checkout on the previous commit, which is this one. So do git checkout. This is what I did. I mean, I just randomly taken commits and I tried to compile the project with this commit. So for example, you take this one and you say the same as before. You do cargo build dash dash release, you wait until it builds, and then you basically open another terminal, you say bash, you go to this directory, which is me delta experiment, and then you run this command again. So here it finished compiling. You run this this command again, and if you run it now, it should work. So after you see that this works in this commit, you can assume that the bug was introduced after this. So for example, we can try this one, the next one. Let's do it again. So we are on this terminal. And no, sorry, do the checkout and then build it, of course. This now will run with the build of the new commit. You build it, you run it. And as you can see, here I'm typing, but nothing really shows. So I just said it looks like the government was introduced in this commit, and so now we can see what changed in this commit. This is one reason why you shouldn't change too much on a single commit, because if there is a problem, if you do small changes, you can identify which change were introduced the problem. So this commit, by the way, is not really that big. These are all tests. So then here said that aggressive wrote some bad process management code, and there's a race condition. So what he is referring to is this one, because he changed how he did this this process stuff. So what I did, I went through the documentation of these methods, wait, code, but really everything was fine with this. So I did some experiments, and I mean, what changed is that he now read this variable here. He passed this variable from as a function argument. So let me expand. This is a function. Yeah, it takes this function as an argument. I mean, nothing should be wrong about this, but after a few experiments, what I found is that if you pass this function as a this parameter as an argument, it basically doesn't work. So this issue was due to the fact that this argument is you added this parameter. So first, before, what you add is that you created the writer here. So you say let's mute writer, and you create it here, while instead here you take it as a parameter. So after a few debugging, I just did the PR in order to fix this quickly. I mean, because it's not that good that you cannot use this program again. So what I did is, I mean, it's an hack. I also told this in the PR comment. Basically, pass this here an option. So from the code, I pass none, and if it is none, I create this writer as it was created before. And from the tests, because here you are in the test, you just say sum and then you pass it, because the problem is that I couldn't revert this, because this was passed from the tests. And so thankfully Dan looked at the, I mean, he said, can you explain why this fixes the problem? And I said, not really, because I just noticed it and I did a quick fix. But luckily he found a cleaner solution, which is this one. And this is where this is, he found the solution basically. So the problem is that when you do process exit, the drop method of a Rust object, we can say, I don't know if you call it an object in Rust. The drop method of an object is not called. So what he did is forced this object to call the drop method before doing a process exit. Yeah, here it is explained. This is from the documentation. Note that because this function never returns process exit, it just terminates the process. So no destructors on the current stack or any other thread stack will be run. And so let's see better what this means. Cargo new drop sample. And then CD, no, let's open from here, open folder, drop example, okay. So we are in the main. So you can see that here we are in the, it's printing hello from main, and here it is dropping it is calling the drop method. So we can do a better example. For example, here fn I don't know, helper one. We can move this code here, and we can call it helper one, and then hello from main one and hello from main 2. So what was happening here before we edited this is that this function, this this I mean this drop method is called after the object goes out of scope. So what does it mean? The scope of this object basically it's let's say that we can say that it's surrounded so the scope of an object ends when you cannot use it anymore. So for example here it ends here where the program ends. So we create this the object, we print, and then we reach the end of this block, and so the drop is the drop method is called. Here instead what we are doing, we are creating a function. So this object will end its scope here, and so it will print dropping as drop, and then after the so after this function, so here it will print another time hello from main. Okay, so let's do cargo run, and okay, sorry, yeah, well, basically what is happening here is that here we are calling the first one is this one, because you are calling the helper function one. Then we do hello main 2 and it's calling the other one, but it's a little bit confusing. Let's remove this. So you can see that here we're doing hello main, we enter here, we go here, we create this object, but immediately after that the scope of this object ends and it calls the drop method. So we will go back here and we do a print line where we print this. Okay, what's the problem? For example, let's say that here we put, okay, I mean here we explain, we use this function to explain better the concept. Let's return to our first example, and here we call process exit. We run it again, and you see that the drop method is not called here, because basically, I mean, even if you put other stuff here, it's just it, the Rust compiler is so nice to tell you that this is an unreachable statement. But yeah, let's just run it. Basically, after the process exit command, nothing else is executed. And so the drop, I mean this print line for sure, but also the drop method should be run here is not run. And yeah, in Rust the drop method is not used just to print a line to the screen. It's used for a very important reason. And I mean in this case, so here this the problem is that this writer it was not the drop of this writer was not called, and that's why you get these strange issues. So he forced the drop type to be called. So if we try this in our code, okay, we can remove this because we are using it. Fail to resolve, let's just import mem. So we added this use and let's run it again. And as you can see here, since we are forcing the object to the drop method, here it's called, but you can do it for example also here before the print statement. You see the drop method is called before. I mean, this can work and this was merged, but if we take a look at the process exit documentation, it tells you a really nice way to call process exit without calling explicitly the drop method. So what you can do is you can remove all your application logic from the main and put it in another function, and then at the end you can call process exit. For example, so basically, let's say that we want to print these two things. If you do like this, it doesn't. So let's do it again. This. If we do it like this, you can see that the drop method is not called. But if we create another function, run app, so like this, and we call it from main. Sorry, run app. Okay, and you call it from main. So what do you expect here? Basically, here we print, and then here the end of the scope of this object is reached, and so here the drop method is called, and then we can do process exit. So let's run it, and as you can see, we were right. So from the Rust docs, this is the best way to call the process exit. By the way, if you don't know, the process exit ends the program by returning a given code. So for example, here we can return 1, and as you can see that my prompt will switch to red here because when you return 1, in Linux, it means that there was an error. And so after this, after finding this, what I've done is that I created a new pull request, refactor main, in order to call process exit once, because really that's what you should do. I removed this. So as you can see here, we had the main that called process exit a lot of times. So from what we knew, maybe there were other constructors that were not called properly and it wasn't really nice. So I did what the standard library suggested. I created a function run app that returns an i32 that contains the exit code value. So instead of calling process exit and ending the project, the program here, I just return an OK with the exit code you want to return. And here, the same, instead of calling memdrop directly, I just return the proper exit code. And now the main was abstracted from that function, and this is what I do. I say exit code equal run app, and here the very last command of the main is this process exit, where I exit with the right exit code. This is just an I32, so there is no constructor to be called here, and the world is better now. Okay, so thank you for listening to this. I know it was a little, it was not really prepared, so I know that the explanation wasn't really that good, but that's what I did. This is my website when I write articles, and I have links to my Twitter, GitHub, LinkedIn, and of course YouTube. You should subscribe to my channel if you want to see more Rust content like this. So thanks.